Hi, so let's begin with pandas, and in this lecture we'll be discussing what pandas are and how we use pandas for data science and AI. So in this session we will look at a common data analysis library for Python known as pandas. For this module we will look at the basics of importing data, looking at two main types of object which Panda provides, the data frame and data series objects, as well as ways of manipulating these and interacting with them. The primary motivation behind using pandas is that it's a high-level library with few lines of codes. We can do very powerful and robust things to our data. We will be using these in these modules to interrogate some data. Installing. It is unlikely that you will have the pandas pip package already installed. Therefore, we will want to run pip install pandas from a command line to install this, just as we have done before for Jupyter and NumPy. But we can also use some Jupyter functionality here to execute system commands. In case you do not want to open the cmd prompt and type pip install panda, you can just directly type !! pip install on pandas here at the Jupyter notebook cell block, and will automatically execute it and install pandas. Let's talk about import. As always, we need to import our library, typically at the top of our file, just like we did with our NumPy library. I'm going to alias this to pd, as that we don't need to type so many pandas. So import pandas as pd. If we have multiple libraries, we might have something that looks like the following: import numpy as np, import csv, pandas, json. Each of these is executed in order, just as any Python expressions are import and as are keywords which Python recognizes and knows what to do with them. So we import pandas as pd, and when you print the type of the pd, it's a module, it's a class module. Now we have our pandas library imported, we can begin to use some functionality from it. It acts as a big kitchen sink full of useful data analysis utilities. The first thing we need to do is to learn how to load some data in. Python can do this via the read_csv function. You can have a look at this link and find details about it. Looking at the documentation may seem rather overwhelming. The main parameter we're interested in is the non-optional one. The first one, pile path _or_buffer, we can provide this function a location as a string to a file we want to open. This file must be in the CSV format to be interpreted correctly without error. When we invoke call this function, it returns a data frame object. Some convention likes to name the variable returned by read_csv as df for data frame. However, we can use or we can name this something more descriptive. my_data_frame equals pd.read.csv. This is a popular data sim name and it's mostly used. So we initialize the iris.csv using pandas.read_csv code and initialize in the variable my_data_frame. We can check the type of my_data_frame to verify what it is. If you type print and type my_data_frame is class pandas core frame data frame. So it is a data frame now. The last line of the notebook cell is what's output from the cell itself. Jupyter has some nice ways of interpreting data frames for display. If we use print, it looks horrible. But if we leave it out for a Jupyter, we get a much better print. So this is ugly if you have a, but if you just put my data frame, look at it. It has a more prettier display. It is exactly the same as the previous one, but this is more better visually. So all the differences of the print command, that's it. So let's talk about data frames and series. Python has two data objects. One are data frames and the others are series. Series, what is a series in a panda? A series object is one dimensional data structure. It stores sequential values. Each value has an index. This is conceptually similar to a Python list. However, with all pandas object, we have additionally functionality defined which can make use of. So data frame. This represents a 2D or more data structure. It is essentially a standard table which consists of rows of data records where each column is an attribute. Each column has its data attribute name and each row has an index starting from 0. You can see the documentation here on the link for further referencing and detailed studies. And during the lecture, you will see a different types of series and data frames. So we'll have a look at it. So indexing data frames. We can obtain an entire attribute column by indexing it from the data frame. Previously, we were used to indexing elements directly, where these represented the unique people through our data set. However, here we're looking at getting all of a special attribute. So our data set contains 5 data attributes. They are as following: sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width, and flower name. We can index a given data frame by use of square brackets, as we would expect. However, this behaves similarly to a dictionary in that our attribute names are actually strings. If we wanted a list of column headings, we can just use mydataframe.column as an attribute. Then it will give you all the columns within the data frame. From this, we can see the column headings of sepal length is called sepal length. This can be any name in our CSV file. It could be something like sepal length millimeter, which might one expect from more user-friendly data. If you open the CSV file provided in a notepad, you can see the headers are what our data frame is using it. It automatically grabbed them for us when creating the original data frame. So let's have a look at our CSV file. You can try open it on the notebook too, but I'm more comfortable using the Excel. So what Python does is, in Pandas, using Pandas, it automatically grabs the first index 0 column to give you the headers, which is sepal.length, sepal.width, sepal.petal.length, petal.width, and variety. So, if you type sepal underscore length, my data frame sepal.length, so it will initialize all the values of sepal.length into the variable sepal underscore length. You can go in and give it a shot. And if you print the type of the sepal length, this should give you a series object. As if we have taken a single column, it represents a 1D structure. We can print this by typing type sepal.length, and the type will come out as series. So let's have a look. Print my underscore data frame dot columns, or for C in my data frame dot columns, print C. So if you use the first command, it will give you an index in a list. It gives you the headers, because at the zero index, the zero column in a CSV, it's always the headers. Then if you want a line by line print in a new line, you can use the for command, just like I've used it for column. There you go. And if you print the type command, it will tell you the sepal underscore length, which is actually sepal.length from the CSV file, from the my data frame. The type of it is pandas series. So let's have a statistical measure of data series. We can calculate some very simple statistical measures of our data for this column. Let's look at min, max, mean, median, and mode. The first 4 are all measures which work on numbers. The latter, mode, is for categorical data, such as the variety of flowers. There are only 3 types of flowers. These are all methods defined upon a data series object, so we can just invoke them. This is just like we had for NumPy matrices. So if you take print sepal.length.min brackets, you can get the minimum of the column. And if you use the max command, you can get the maximum of the column. If you can use the mean command, you can get the mean of the whole column in the series, of course. And this is for the median, and this is 5.8. But remember, this has to be series. There you go. And these are the codes for that. SQL underscore lens dot min, and you have to do a print command and so on. If you can see, and if you go back in your CSV file, where there are so in the sepal.length, which is sepal.length in your CSV file, there you go. So if we use a filter here, and according to our pandas, the minimum value is 4.3 here. Let's have a look. And if you see, the minimum value here is 4.3. And according to our pandas, the maximum value is 7.9. And so on. You can also get the mean and the medians and so on. So let's talk about F strings. So this is a way to print within your print statements, and it makes data more readable and user friendly, and actually gives the reader an idea what the print is about. And so to achieve this, we use the F strings. If you want something fancier printing, we can use a Python 3.6 feature called fstrings. This allows us to directly insert variables into strings for the purpose of display without having to worry about concatenation. Example, here's a good example for it. So if you use this code and print, you can see F, we can print, write normal strings with it. And if you put some variable, a variable, let's say 42, some underscore var is 42. Also, input variables like 42 in it. So now when you mention within the curly brackets, whatever the variable is, and if the variable has an, let's say even an integer value, if you're using F before the, after the print and before the actual string, you can actually use the values, whatever the variable holds. So let's use these with our fancy statistical metrics to print this up better, nicer. So if you can see, I've used the same method, the fstring method, to print my sepal length minimum using the curly brackets method. And within them is directly, I've inserted the formula for the minimum maximum, or the syntax for the minimum maximum. And there you go. It is more fancier to read it now. It actually tells the user what you're trying to do. Okay, now let's look at the last one of our things we were mentioning, which was min, max, median. Now we're going to talk about mode. So if we use this on the sepal length, it's not a very useful. Length is a continuous bit of data, so we will use it on the variety. This method behaves differently, as it returns them in order of the most common to least. So this result is actually a data series itself. Very confusing, I know. So modes equals to my data frame variety dot mode. So this is the command, this is the syntax for mode. Whatever the column is, you add dot mode there. And if you want to print it in, like, let's say in lines, you can use a for command and print m within the modes, which is the data frame of the variety series using the code mode. So when you use the command above, you get three printouts. So Setosa is the most common one, Versicolor is the second one, and Virginica is the third one. Let's talk about unique, describe, and count. We also have methods for obtaining the amount of unique values in a given attribute column. In our case, this is useful to verify. We only have three types of flowers. So if you use the command dot unique within the variety, it also gives you the unique commands. You don't have to actually do this for the mode. You can also get the unique command uniqueness of different types of data categories by using the unique command. So but let's say I want to use the count. I want to know the count of it. So dot count bracket provides us with a way of finding all non-null elements within a column. So if you use the dot count, this may be different than the numbers of rows you expect. So when you do it, it's 150. You can go and have a look. Finally, dot describe. This one is kind of an easy and better way for analysis using pandas. So dot describe allows us to look at various qualities of the data frame of the series. Print my data frame variety, and when you use dot describe, so when you use the command, have a look. It gives you a display where it tells you the count, the unique values, the top value, the frequency, and the name, and the D type, if it's an object, and the name of the column, which is variety. So note, many of these functions actually work on the whole data frame itself. So if you want to use the describe, you can use it on the column, but you can actually use it on the whole data frame itself. I mean, you do not have to put a bracket and define the column name and then use the describe command. You can directly use on the whole data frame and use the describe command. So once you do it, let's say my underscore data frame dot describe, it gives you all the column names and their count, their mean, their standard deviation, their minimum, their 25% percentile, 50 percentile, 75 percentile, and the maximum within them, all of them in the floats. So there you go. This is the Pandas lecture, and we will be discussing more in detail in the workshop for week 4 about pandas. So see you there. In the next video, we'll be talking about seaborn. So yeah, see ya. Bye.